it is so important that we are active and we're activated. And that's what I'm, when I'm saying that this activation is here. We had young, very young women put together our marches here, and they were largely peaceful. That was so inspiring to see. It's like, I'm gonna go out there with my mask on and be there because a young person cares, a 19, 18, I think 20 year old. That says a lot, because we discount that younger generation of people. We say all they wanna do is TikTok and, you know, do makeup tutorials. But no, they are out there really trying to activate, and that is so inspiring. But in Youngstown, we don't have a lot of police brutality. We have some, you know, but we don't have it so prevalent, and they don't, they really hunker down on those, you know, high crime areas. But we do need policy change. We do need procedural change, and we need leaders at the helm that will recognize those changes and make those changes. That's important. When we talk about, you know, defunding the police, you can't fund them and keep the same rule book. You gotta work the whole system. And I think that's really important for us to take our lesson in. We can't take it in and think, wait 5 or 10 years. No, we have to take the lesson in and make the changes now. The leaders have to stand up and make decisive action, firm action. And if we gotta have a good lawyer behind them to defend it, we gotta have that too. So that's important for this moment, and for us to really come out of this moment with some real change behind it.
So many young people like yourself, of any race, but right now particularly focusing on African Americans, leave the area and they go to bigger cities because I'm assuming they don't feel like there's the opportunity here, and you don't see a lot of high level managers, if you will, in our corporations or businesses who are African American. And I think it's because they have moved and found opportunity elsewhere. How do we rectify that?
Again, that starts with the school system. It starts with our education system. I think I mentioned you before that I didn't feel like why she was for me, right? I didn't think that becoming an adult in Youngstown was really for me. So when I went to Florida, I think I may have come home once over the course of 8 years. And that says a lot, because in the one time I did come home, I was like, oh, I don't know why I came home. I don't know anyone here, you know? But I became an adult somewhere else with other people, and that was great for me. But as a young professional here, when I first got here, my cousin who went to just Bowling Green, and she's working on her doctoral degree, she was here, and she was like, there's nothing here, I can't find a job. And if I do find a job, when you look at their management structure and their upward mobility, it's gonna be 20 years before I can move up, because the person that is that's above me has no plans to retire. And you can hear that in the conversation. And she goes to Mississippi and she works there for a couple of years. And then she comes back to Youngstown. And I said, well, are you looking for a job in Youngstown? I'm so excited because I'm like, I just believe and I love it here. And she's like, yeah, I'm looking for work here. And she had a call from Columbus and they were like, hey, you know, we saw your resume, come down for an interview. She went down and it was amazing. So now she's in a position in Columbus now. She's down in Franklin County where a lot of my friends are. They see opportunity there. They see potential for growth there. And they're just like, it's time for me to go. You know, the days of us working for 40 years at a YMHA or Ohio Edison or a GM, those days are gone. We won't have those. So at this point in Youngstown, if you're a young minority, you're creating work, but it's hard to create work when your population is shrinking. You know, when the people you serve, they're aging, and you have all your young people going to Atlanta and Columbus and Cleveland and Pittsburgh and New York and out west. So that's a catch for us too. But the opportunity hasn't been here unless you create it yourself. And the only reason why I see it is because, you know, my grandfather, although he was a bailiff for the city for over 30 years, he owned, you know, three businesses. My father worked for Ohio Edison for 40 years, but he owned a business as well. So I naturally felt connected to Youngstown, and I naturally was like, if I can make it in Youngstown, I can make it anywhere, you know. So when I came back, I just really looked hard for opportunity, and I was able to find it. I was able to find it, like with Rotary, you know. Our theme this year is Rotary opens opportunities, and that was an opportunity for me to see that, you know, work doesn't have to be regimented. It doesn't have to be a corporate structure. You might have to think outside the box and work in nonprofit, and that's really what it kind of came to me is, you know, service was something that I love. So I began to work and do a lot of work in nonprofit work. So that was really great. But as far as our young African-American community, our young minority community, you know, it's hard if you are a regimented person and you want to work in a corporate setting and you want to work, I want to go to work, I want to come home, and this is not a place for you. But if you are someone who wants to build and begin a business, you know, depending on what you're doing, this is a place for you.
You are very ambitious. You persevere in what you want, and I assume you got a lot of that from your grandpa and your dad, and seeing them in business. Your dad's still in business. What would you say you learned from them?
First, from my grandpa, I learned you got to go vote. Day one, my mom instills that too, but gotta go vote. Being active. My grandfather, they used to have precinct committee meetings at the house, and you know, everybody, you know, knew him, called on him for anything, and he just had that all-consuming love, you know. So that, just being open, I learned that from my grandpa Sonny Man. And if someone wants to talk, you talk to them. You know, you try to remember who they are. He'd sit there and he'd talk to you. He probably could tell you, you know, who your grandfather was and where they worked after you had a few conversations, and he kind of connected the dots from what side of town and who went where. And I learned that from both of them. My father's the same way. It's just to be personable. That goes a long way. And to be there for people and to just have that selfless love. Those are the big things. I think that has carried me through, you know, most of all the decisions that I make, is just to be selfless and be open for change and talk to people, let people talk and figure out, hey, all right, how can I help you? And I'm here to help you and really help them.
Built for the 21st century American workforce, Eastern Gateway Community College has two campuses and is a national leader in online learning. EGCC.edu is a digital gateway where 30,000 students are quickly transforming their financial futures through degrees, certificates, transferable credits, and higher paying jobs. And now, residents of the Mahoning Valley can enroll in summer classes for free. It's the EGCC Summer Guarantee. Eastern Gateway, America's new workforce starts here.